Joel 2:28, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions." It is time to spread the undiluted gospel to the dying world. An expository moment wrapped up with the power of the Holy Ghost. This is Pure Gospel Moment with Mark Miracle. Get set for an encounter with the God who changes identity.
Now we are talking about connect to source. For an electric bulb to shine the light it has to be connected to the power source. Everything you see physically comes from the spirit, comes from the spiritual realm. Everything I am seeing physically comes from the spiritual realm, from the unseen realm. Now, I should also let you know that if you don't know how to connect the source, Satan can joke with your destiny. Somebody say, God forbid.
God forbid.
So you need to know how to connect to source and stay to source. Are you understanding me?
Yes, sir.
Power is available, but only those who reach out to it and stay connected to it can benefit of it. Can reduce it a little bit. Power is available. There is power available to move this man. There's power available for us to have light, but you can't have it until you are connected. So I want you to flow with me. This teaching I want to teach today, I haven't taught like this before. So are you permitting me to teach like this?
Yes, sir.
Should I teach the pure gospel truth?
Yes, sir.
You won't be offended today.
Yes.
I should say the truth today.
Yes,
the way the truth is.
Yes.
I should write on.
Yes,
praise the Lord. And I see God blessing somebody today in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Now, in this kingdom, you cannot violate principles. This kingdom we are in, the kingdom of God, you can't violate principles. Why do I say this? Because the ones who violated principles had their ways, their testimonies forgone. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 5 to 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not in your own understanding. Let pastor preach, but this is what I think." No. You are leaning in your understanding. Oh, what pastor said today is true, but you are leaning in your own understanding. He says, "Trust in the Lord and all with all your heart, and lean not in your own understanding. In all your ways submit to Him, and He will make you your path straight." In all your ways, do what? Connect to Him. In everything you do, connect to Him. In business, connect to Him. In family, connect to Him. In everything you do, do what? Connect to Him. And He will make your path what? Straight. I said in this kingdom, you can't violate principles. Adam violated the principle of obedience, and the world is still suffering for it today. God said, "Do not eat this. Do not do this one. Do not disobey me." Adam disobeyed. Till today, the world is suffering for it. He violated the principle of obedience. Esau violated the principle of firstborn rights. Esau and Jacob went and sold his rights because of a morsel of a meal. "Can you give me this your meal? I need to eat. I am very hungry." Jacob said, "Will you sell your firstborn rights to me?" He sold it, and the blessings shifted from Esau to Jacob, who is now the father of Israel. Why? Esau violated them. God does not think, God does not look at that you are small or big. As long as you violate. The consequences follow the person. That is why I'm telling you, give me permission to talk to you today with the depth of truth. Samson violated the principle of secrecy, and he lost his might and life. Samson did what? Violated the principle of secrecy. The principle of secrecy demands that you keep what is meant to be secret, secret. They told you this, keep it secret. He knew his threat was on his head. He went and violated that principle. Did God forgive him because he was strengthened enough? Did God forgive him because he's a Jew? Did God forgive him because he's a servant? No, he violated and he was punished. Much as you violate any law, the person is meant to be punished. If negative and positive wire are exposed, like the ones you are seeing up now, they use masking tape to hold it so that the two of them will not join. When they join, will you say because it's inside church, it will not spark?
No.
You violated, it will spark. Even though it's inside church, it will spark. So when you violate principles in this kingdom, consequences are meant to follow. If you violate this principle of insulation, in electricity, You cause a spark and damage. I know an old man in my village that time. He is a pastor. God was moving him, moving him, moving him. He was praying. There is power. There is electric power when it comes on you. I told you, when I went outside to chill off, my legs were shaking. I couldn't move my leg. So me too, I contacted something. I had to sit down a little bit and stood up. I saw God manifesting greatly this morning, and it has not ended. He will do it more in your life. He will do it more. So this man was praying. Their generator was giving problem. It sounds like a joke, but it's a very, very, it's real, it's true. So this man prayed, people fall, touch, he says, we fall. Generator started giving problem. Light started shaking. This man went and said he wants to pray for the wire, not even to touch them. Say if we touch the wire, then the thing will stop disturbing. This man went and touched the wire, and as I'm talking to you, he's not alive today. He wants to pray for. I know the man. He wants to touch my. He violated the principle of insulation. Insulation means the man that these lights are insulated with rubber. You don't touch the main cable. When you touch the main cable, it does not respect that you are a man of God. It shocks you immediately because you disobey the principle. Do you understand me? That is why we are talking about that principle of connecting to the source. And today, I want to talk about four proven steps to connecting to the source in this kingdom. How do I connect to the source in this kingdom? Four proven steps. I can teach it here with the language I'm teaching with. Go to another church today, we tell you the same thing. Go to another place, they will tell you the same thing. Because these things work everywhere as one principle. You can't cheat on God, and I can't cheat on God. I said what? Four proven steps to connecting to the source. Number one, connect to the altar. You want to connect to the source? I told you this man wasn't moving, but it was connected to the source. Number one, connect to the altar. Now follow me now like somebody running after a bell. Connect to the altar. Altars are shortcuts to communing with deities. Nobody communes with God without an altar. You can't talk to God without an altar. Altars are shortcuts to talking with God. I want to ask you a question. How come Balak was not able to curse the children of Israelites? Saw the children of Israel coming, he would have said, I curse the children of Israel. He was not able to curse them because he needed an altar. And for you to get an altar, you need a priest. I'll get to the priest. We are talking about altar now. So Balaam reached out for Balak, saying, come and help me curse these children of Israel. Was Balak, who was the priest, even able to curse the Israelites? No, he said, set up seven altars. He said what? Set up seven altars. And in the book of Revelation, we hear about the seven candlesticks, seven churches. The altar represents the church. Connect to church. That's what I mean by connect to altar. In the book of Revelation, chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you see Jesus walked in the midst of the seven candlesticks. He says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. He said to the church of Pergamos, I am this. To the church in Samaria, I am this. To the church of Ephesus, I am this. He mentioned seven churches. And these seven churches represent the seven altars that Balaam built. First Numbers chapter 23 verse 1 says, and Balaam said unto Balak, build me here seven altars, and prepare me here seven oxen and seven rams, so that he can be able to curse the children of Israel. Balaam, the king of Moab, got threatened of the Israelites and contracted prophet Balaam to curse the Israelites. But to prove that you need an altar to commune with deities, Prophet Balaam himself requested for an altar to be built. Although it turned out for the good of the Israelites, he was building the altar to curse the children of Israel, but whom God has not cursed, nobody can curse. Rather that he was not proclaiming blessings. We'll deal more in this scripture next week. Now let me tell you this, follow me in your spirit mind. Altars shorten the distance between heaven and earth. Church, when I mean altar, I'm talking about church. It shortens the distance between heaven and earth. It says, ye are seated in heavenly places. Who is seated in heavenly places now? You are seated in heavenly places. This shortens it. So you want to connect to source, connect to church. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You want to connect to source, you connect to church. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. believe.
You want to connect to us, you connect to church. Are you understanding me? Church here represents altar. Who is understanding the message now? Step by step. You understanding it? You're welcome, great man of God, sir. Please have a seat in God's presence. Now, 2 Kings chapter 21, verse 4 says, and he built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord said, in Jerusalem will I put my name. Said he built altars in the house of the Lord. I am taking you step by step. I said forward, proving steps of connecting to the source. Number one is connect to the altar. Number two, connect to the priest on the altar. Number three, connect to the message of the priest. Number four, connect to the fire on the altar. Now we are talking about connect to the altar. Hallelujah.
Christ.
You can't make it alone without an altar. You need an altar. You need a church. You can't stand alone like that and say, I can make it to heaven without even going to church. You can't. Say, do not forsake the gathering of thy brethren together. Can anyone graduate from university without entering the four walls of university? Would they give you certificates? Can anyone be called a trader without learning trade? Can anyone be called fashion designer without having fashion machine and all the rest? Can you learn oil pipe welding without, as in, can you weld pipeline without learning it first and be certified?
No.
You can't. You can't be called a Christian without having a church you attend. You can't cheat God. When he comes to church, God is saying, I can be a Christian without going to church. Why not be a graduate without going to university? You can't cheat on God. Connect to source. You can't make it in life if you don't believe that the powers of the altars are existing on earth and they control this earth. We have the powers of the negative altar and the powers of the positive altar. The positive altar is here where we are. You know, after service like this, some people, they go to the village where they do one or two things, push them up and come back. Yes, because they go to the altars in the village. So this world is ruled by two altars. The church where we are and the shrine. So which one are you connected? You can't be in the middle of the road. I cannot be in the middle of the road. Do you understand me? You can't make it alone without an altar. You need an altar. Don't say, even though I don't go to church today, I am a Christian. No, you can't violate principles. You can't do what? You can't violate principles. That's why I told you about Esau. He violated his firstborn right. I told you about Samson. He violated the secret sin like right. I told you about Adam. He violated the right of obedience, the principle of obedience. Altars are mysterious, and those who neglect altars have their destiny vanishing mysteriously. But this thing pastor is talking, I can't just understand it. How is church an altar? I can't just melt it down. It is mysterious. Leave it like that. Just swallow it like that. That altars are mysterious. Just thinking that church is an altar. Until you see the church as a sacred altar, you won't be serious with the church. You see his church as a sacred altar, you won't be serious. Until you know that the church is a sacred place where you communicate with deity, you won't. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Now, how do I connect to the church? How do I connect to the New Testament altar? A, belong to a church. Be active and not just a number. Be active in your local church. Don't just be a number, be a member. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 25 says, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exalting one another, and so much the more, as ye see the day approaching. Don't neglect the altar. Don't get to a point in life and say, I can't go today, I can't do this today. Until you see church as a sacred altar, you will not give it that place it needs. You can't joke with school. You will call somebody, call rep, write my name for me, please. I don't want to have carryover. I don't want to have absence in church in school. You respect your certificates because you don't want to joke with it. Why not follow God like that? Have you seen somebody who follows school, follows the course, follows the lecturer very well, and fails out? He won't, because you follow very well. You think God will fail you if you follow him like that? He can't. B, take the altar serious. The altar, when I'm talking about the altar, I mean your church. Take it serious. Give it a business approach if you want God to bless you truly. Give that church a business approach. The way you bath, dress up and go to church, keep to work, give church a business approach. Dress up so neatly fitted. Spray the best of perfume you can. Dress, wear the best of shoe you can. Don't appear sheepishly. Say, God, it is your business I am coming. I'm coming to seek you in truth and in spirit. Come with the mind of a business, business-minded person. Say, it is God I am going for today. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. All things work together for their own good. Do not let your personal routines clash with the routines of the church. Don't let your personal things, even though you are going to school, you can never allow your personal chores to affect your school studies. Why not live like that with church too? Don't allow personal things. This is an altar we are talking about. Don't allow personal things to make you choke with the altar of God. Understand the vision. Okay, the altar, that is the church, is your home and family. So service the altar the same way you would maintain your home from decaying. This altar, this church is your house. What did Balaam tell Balak? He said, set up 7 altars, bring bullocks, animals, so I can service your request. Service the altar, see the altar as your home. Don't get to a church. It looks, water is leaking from the ceiling. Say, Pastor, we do it. I hope you have permission. You gave me permission to talk to you today.
Yes.
I should still continue.
Continue.
Don't get to a church and look. Something is falling off the wall and you're waiting for Pastor to do it. You are waiting for somebody to do it. You are not serious yet. You are joking with the altar. You have not given it the business approach it needs. You have not given it all it demands from you. See, when you violate principles, the results won't yield. But when God sees your heart and says, this man, this person has something extraordinary that I have to go all out to bless the person to. Don't ever enter church and say, church needs something like this. Don't wait until pastor announces on the altar. With the eyes, even if you are connected to the altar, you will see what the church needs. And say, God, it is through me, this one will be done. Do you understand me? Say, through me, this one will be done. Through me, this one will be done. Now we are running on NEPA. Before NEPA, I was connected to him. We have somebody that every time he will send fuel. Every time, even though you can't bring it, he will send somebody. Saturday night, they will bring fuel. Do you think God can look at that person and allow any evil affect the person?
Yeah.
We had love class last Saturday. We said, oh, no need to use drug. I said, please save your money. I tried to even discourage the young man. He said, no need for drug. Keep the money. Use it for something else. Said, okay, sir, on Friday, Saturday, they called me, the drum is coming to church 5 minutes before night. I told my wife, said, this man is desperate. And God will do desperate thing with him. Saturday, drums were there, Sunday. The service, the evening was like a concert if you were here at that time. So, see something in the hearts of God and say, this one, I will do this thing. This one, if you know me, I don't preach this kind of messages every time. But God told me, how long will you not tell the people the truth? You are depriving them of their blessings. Because we have this mentality sometimes, well, not us, not this church. People have that mentality that if you tell them do this, they think pastor is asking for something. No, but I rather tell you the truth and you feel like that. I want you to be blessed. Do you understand me?
Yes.
E, understand the vision and the driving message of the altar. Understand the vision of the altar you are. Don't just attend church and say, I went to church today and I left. Do you understand the core value of that church? Every church are not the same. Hence, you must know the core vision of the church you are submitting to, the altar you are submitting to. For instance, PGC, our vision is to manifest truth, transformation, and solution to the problems of man. That is why we say our flyer, we say the place of truth, solution, and perfection. That is our core value. So when you enter, you know what is driving that altar. So you connect to the message of that altar. The altar here is a winner's champ is liberation mandate, right? Salvation ministry is what? Establishing the kingdom of God here on earth. So many other persons have their own. Our own God says, transforming our generation. He says the place of truth, solution, and perfection. So when you enter here, they say the place of truth, you already fix your mind that this pastor is like, you'll be telling truth, truth all the time with my beating heart. So just position your mind as a place of truth. You know that it's a place of solution. You know that when you enter, this altar carries solution. So when instructions comes, I must do that in the same. Because for him to say it's a place of solution, he has a covenant with God to be working as solution for people. And it's the place of perfection. Now God lined it up. Without solution, you can't have perfection. And without truth, you can't have solution. Truth brings solution and solution brings perfection. So when you understand the way it's lined out, you are not just sitting. You understand the church. You understand the message of the church. You understand the core value of the altar. So you easily benefit. When blessings come out, you easily benefit because you know what God is doing in that place. So you are not just a novice. You know the power that is behind the altar. You don't just enter a church without really a core vision. That's why when you enter a company, the HR, human resource management, will call you and say, this is the core value of this organization. They tell you that so that you put your skills and the organizational techniques you have ever learned anywhere to make them actualize the goal of the company. They have their own goal. Every church has a message. You say, but all of us are church. Why don't we have different messages? That's why there are different prophets in the Bible. All of them had different messages. F, brand your pages with the true gospel from the altar. All of us are in social media page. If you don't have anything from the church on your page, it means you are ashamed of your church. And we as a church, there is no week we don't, after this service, now you see these quotes. You will see this message, the whole note on our page. You read them, you don't just read, share them. You see them on WhatsApp status, don't do as if you didn't see it. You can't play with God like that and expect God will bless you, but the altar, the place you are being serviced, there is a blessing you need to die from that place. Luke chapter 9 verse 26 says, for whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, if you are ashamed of the messages from this altar, if you are ashamed of the designs, the flyers, the things from this altar, and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed. Should I still continue with the truth?
Yes.
I should be one preaching.
Yes.
Somebody angry already?
No.
Okay. So, tell yourself, oh, on Facebook, wow, this is a flyer for the next program. Don't be happy if you don't even share it. Share. People are seeing it and they are being saved. Most of the persons here, we came through social media. Yes, we are trying one-on-one evangelism, but many are still coming through social media. So why not bless somebody? Why not share the post? Why not share the messages of salvation coming from the altar? Say, for whosoever shall be ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of the person too. Don't be ashamed of the things that come from this altar. Who is being blessed? G, don't allow problems make you leave church. This is a warning. Don't allow what? Don't get to a point in time and say, because of this, I will not be in church. No! That is the work of the devil. Satan separates a believer from protection of the altar before he strikes. Satan will look at it and say, no matter the problem, because the problems came for there to be a solution. So why now neglect to go to a place where there's a solution? Because we have problem. I have problem. This prayer has not been answered. I will not go to church. I told them on Friday, I said, today you have Ada, what is her name, that used to sing with Flavor? Chidima, she's now a gospel artist. You have Dibanj, he wants to feature Moses Bliss now. They were all worldly people. And you can imagine people in the church are making guys to leave church. And this one didn't happen. Pastor didn't give me money now. Pastor didn't contribute to this. Church didn't give me this one. Church didn't do this one for me. I am leaving. But the ones in the world, the ones judged are coming back to church. The bunch of all persons are coming, is coming back to church. Chidima is in church now. He's singing with Mercy Chimo and crew. If they are leaving the world, they have tasted it more than you can even taste it. Did everything they can do and they leave it and come back. You that is in church, say, I will leave, I will not come. Let me tell you something. Say, if the people will not praise him, say, you will raise the stones. And these stones will cry out in praise. And we remember, we call these sinners stony-hearted people. That they are stony-hearted. You preach, they don't hear. He said, you will raise those stones and they will cry out in praise. Don't allow the worldly men to come and take your seat in church. Am I speaking to somebody? Don't allow problems. Maybe say, I will not again. No way. Why am I telling you to connect to the altar, to the church? One, benefits. The gate of hell shall not prevail against the church. Is that what God said?
Yes.
If the gate of hell cannot prevail against church, who is the church? Is it not you, church? So first of all, see yourself as the church. How will you not see yourself as the church and you are not in church? When you see yourself as the church, I say, Mom, Dad, no matter everything that happens, I will be in church. When you see yourself as the church, the gate of hell can never prevail against you. Two, you will grow with the pace of the church. As the church is growing, you will be growing because you see yourself as the church. Number two thing I say you'll be connected to is what? Connect to the priest on the altar. Who understood connect to the altar? Connect to church? Now connect to the priest on the altar. That is the pastor. An altar is inactive without a priest. A church is inactive without a pastor. An altar is what? Inactive without a priest. Why didn't Balak set up an altar to curse the Israelites by himself? Because he's not a priest. Balak is a king. Leave this thing. Don't be thinking, don't ever calculate God. You can't. Balak was a king. Why did he set altar and say, I curse to the Israelites, I curse in the name of the Lord? That is not his office. This is an office, the office of a pastor. And as you follow me, you will understand deep remark. Balak couldn't curse. He needed Balak to curse. So he called Balaam. Now Balaam, who is a priest, understood the altar, connect to altar, which I have finished teaching now. He told him, set up an altar. We are done with the altar. So you must be connected to the priest of the altar before what is working on the altar can work on you. Do you understand me? Before what is working on the altar can work on you. Why did Balaam call on Balaam? Because he is not an officiate. He doesn't officiate on the altar. He officiates on the throne. And the throne bows to the altar any day, anytime. Balak couldn't act against the Israelites, even though he hated them so much. He needed a priest. He needed a pastor. Until you obey and reverence your pastor, as sinners fear and reverence juju priests. God will not answer your prayer fast, the same way Satan answer the prayers of juju priests fast. Juju priests will come and say, he will die. Buy gold or not. Buy this one. When you come, don't use your face to enter. Use your back to enter. Do like this. Do like this. Eat the thing and do it. And now call his name 3 times. A person will not go with pen and biro. He will not go with jotter. Yet, the worldly man will do everything exactly the same way they say it. And the person will die. Children of darkness have become wiser than the children of light. The same instruction will be given on the altar. Pastor will say, do this, do that, and you begin to calculate the pastor. You begin to calculate the priest. You begin to calculate the altar. How do you want God to work as fast? Satan, they answer their prayer fast, but it doesn't last for them. When he answer, he can't kill somebody and survive now. So when they use Satan and do their things, they also backfire. Satan imitated this thing from God. We are the original. We are the priests. So when we say this is what God said, do it. We know. Everything I did here today, God revealed them in the room of prayer. Whenever I'm praying by midnight, there's a dangerous hour I commune with God, 11 to 12, sometimes to 1. He keeps on telling me, do this. I keep on writing them down. He keeps me, do this. And as I come and do it, even though he shows me somebody, I say, this thing is what God told me to. I will tell you, I will call you and tell you, this is what God asked me to. If you believe, it works for you. If you don't believe, I cannot force you. Oh, gigi, dema. Now you hold the knife, now you hold the yam. If you want to eat it, you want. If you don't want, mine is to pass the message. But I want you to benefit of it. Luke chapter 24, verse 25 to 26. And he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe what the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ suffered for you? Was it not enough that Christ already died and suffered for you? Why won't you believe what his priest is saying? Why won't you believe what he's saying through the pastor? Every priest must be serviced for the labor for you to yield speedy result. No one goes to juju priest empty-handed. So why do you go to your pastor empty-handed? Should I continue? Have you ever gone to juju priest empty-handed? No, not you. Have any other person gone to juju priest? They don't try it. But you know, in churches these days, anybody can go to pastor empty-handed. But we don't care. But the Bible does not teach like that. You don't meet a priest empty-handed. I don't meet my father's empty-handed. Even if it is 10 naira, 20 naira that you have, that is what you have. Because you respect accept what he carries. I am not begging you, and I can't beg you, but I will teach you the truth. When I was preparing this message, I said, God, can I preach this message? I haven't preached this kind of message before. God said, tell them the truth. You know why? Because you want to raise a chariot of fire, a generation of fire, but you need to understand the truth. I need to understand the truth. Paul and Aaron say, okay, what he's saying, is it biblical? I will show you. Paul and Aaron lifted Moses' arm, and that helped the Israelites to defeat the Amalekites in James English. When the battle was on and on, who was the pastor then? Who was the priest? Moses. Moses lifted his hands. The same way I can lift my hands in prayer, the same way pastors lift their hands in prayer. He gets to a time his hand got weak. He is a man of God, not a God of man. My hands can get weak sometimes. That is where you come to encourage pastor. Pastor, I'm praying for you too. If we don't need your prayer, I'll be very happy to say, yeah, you pray for me. You are home and Aaron that time. You are lifting his hands. So that battle, spiritual battle, is battling for you. Keeps on answering. The widow of Zarephath fed Elijah her last meal, and she was saved from poverty. Elijah told her that, for this is what the Lord called me to. The God of Israel said, the jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day that God sends rain. Elijah prayed till there will be dryness, no rain. He said the prophecy. He suffered it too. There was no food anywhere, no rain. But God told him to go to somewhere, to a brook, that he'll be providing water and food there. There was a time too, water dried in the brook. He now sent him to Zarephath and met a lady. The lady wanted to eat his last meal. He said, do it for me. Go and get me water. The woman was running to go and bring water. He said, no, come back, add food. The woman turned, he asked for water, you're adding food. Pastor, I won't get my own now. This one I have, I will eat it with my son and it will finish. Elijah told him, obey me, make the food. After he finished making the food, that is when he was lavish, he was blessed to speak. He said, the jar of flour shall not be emptied. The jar of oil shall not run dry until the day the famine stops, until the day rain falls. Did he speak that word when he hadn't given her something? Did Balaam want to curse the Israelites until Balaam set up the altar and sacrificed? He didn't. You need to connect to the prophet on the altar. Connect to the priest on the altar. How do I connect? Not just money, not just material things. Connect with prayer. Pray for him from the depth of your heart. Say, God, help him. I know you called him. I know you are using him. Pray for him. Is someone being blessed?
Yes.
Now, priests are not elected by size or age, but by the grace and mercy of God. So no matter how they look, God honors their words because he called them. Priest, no pastor is elected by size. Say, oh, this one is a small boy, this one is a small woman, oh, this one is talking, it really happened. Priests are not elected by size. They are elected by grace. They are elected by mercy. David was 15 years old when Samuel anointed him. David was what? 15 years old when Samuel said, go and call him from the bush. I anointed him. 15 years old. As small as he is, he became a pastor. Joseph was 17 years old when he started speaking through dreams. 17 years old. So we are studying them today, but they started as a child. Esther is predicted to be 14 years old when she took over from Queen Vashti. Jeremiah was between 13 and 16 years old when God called him. Every great name in the Bible, we are young. I am even older than them when God started using them. But God does not work with size. God does not work with height. God does not work with him. This is old, that person, the oldest person. That's why a small child can call you, say, this is what God is telling you. He's a child, right? But God is using him to answer. God does not call priests by size. Connect to them, no matter the size. Don't ever look at them and say, you look down on them. No priest calls himself to the office, so even when they are joking with words, heaven answer. No priests call themselves. When you go to the village, you see juju priests. Do you know that you cannot fear, they fear them, even though it's a child or adult? Because they didn't call themselves. The juju itself choose the person. God choose the pastors, so they didn't call themselves. So connect very well with them. Now, hear me, even in boxers or slippers and singlets, A priest remains a priest. God sees the oil on his head. You are seeing the dressing. For instance, you see me on the road, pants, slippers, native, and walking, casually going. That is the pastor that preached on Sunday. You are seeing somebody on slippers. God is still seeing somebody that he put oil on. So the dressing of the pastor does not matter. That's why a pastor can be on boxers, they call him, he pray, and God answers. Do you understand me? Dressings does not matter, so connect. Every priest is a human, but God's oracle. We are humans, but God's oracle. Oracle means a messenger. As I was praying, God hit the young lady. I went outside to sit down, but he hit me too. I couldn't stand for 5 minutes. I haven't felt that before. So I am a messenger. As I am passing the message, me too, it's rubbing off on me too. Do you understand me? I had to sit outside for 5 minutes before my legs will carry me again. I haven't felt it before. Dehydrated, I wasn't feeling myself. That is what God does. We are oracles. So he is an oracle. Even though you see the human part in them, they are also oracles. 4, lay sacrifices on his life and calling. How to connect to your priests. There are prayers that may not be answered until you move to touch your servant, the God servant. There are prayers that pray in God, I have done this, it has not happened. I have done this one, it has not happened. I have done this one, it has not happened. What is wrong with your pocket? What is wrong with sowing a seed? Because you are seeing maybe it's a young baby boy, it's a young baby child, it's a young woman. I don't just believe in this yet. No. Don't ever act that way. Priests are selected by grace and mercy. And until you see this and begin to walk in that direction, after this message, I'll go and tell God, thank you for giving me the strength to teach this message. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
After this, I'm telling you the truth. I will kneel down and say, God, thank you for giving me the strength. This is one of the most difficult messages pastors preach. Because it looks as if they are asking, but they are not asking. They are telling him the truth. Hallelujah.
Praise
Should
God.
I still continue? Benefits, nobody answered again though. Should I still continue?
Yes, sir.
Benefits of connecting to the priest on the altar. Number one, God easily answers the priest's prayer for you because of your love and honor for him. When God prays, when pastor prays, do you know that there is a way your prayer answers easily because of the way you connect to the priest? Because God doesn't want the priest to bother about you. So quickly, he answers your prayer because he sees your heart. It might not be because of money, but your love towards the pastor, your connection towards him, everything that concerns his family, you just love it. Quickly, he answers you. 2, God reveals what concerns you to him, especially when he's communicating with the altar. I was praying. Most of the persons I called out today, I was praying this night. God was revealing the matters I mentioned. He was revealing them to me as I was praying. When I pray for people, sometimes God showed me some things about them. So when your heart is connected to the priest, quickly God can reveal things to him. Maybe you want to make a journey to somewhere. Because your heart is connected to the priest, maybe the priest is just lying there sleeping. God will just tell him, see this young man in church, call him, tell him not to travel. Why? Because you are already connected to the priest. So God easily picks. Oyedepo wanted to fly in his one of his jets. Adeboye quickly called him. Told him his jet at this point. If we pray, nothing will happen. He still traveled, the jet almost crashed, but it didn't crash. Connectivity, the heart of connectivity. God can speak to your pastor. It's very easy for you to provoke prophecy for yourself through your pastor. Just connect to him with love and honor. Now, the third one. Connect to the message of the priest. The first one is what? Connect to the altar. Number 2, your Lord, connect to the priest on the altar. Number 3, connect to the message of the priest on the altar. The priest is not different from his message. You can't love a pastor and hate his message. Am I speaking to somebody?
Yes.
When you don't like a man, you can't like his message. And when you don't like his message, his prayers can't work for you either. I don't like what he preached today. Now, how will he pray? How will the message now work? How will his prayer work? He might be my younger brother, the one that testified. But there are specific things he must obey for God to answer. He testified today. I give him the instruction, he obeys. Maybe say, it's my brother and I know him now. It's not me and him that grew up together. The same thing will also happen for him. No prayers I pray will answer because he sees me as a brother. But he has to naturally see that this one is my brother, but he's my priest. Do you understand me? We have, no matter how I come down now, after service, now we play, we joke together, I call you on phone, joke with you, smile with you. Also have that at the back of your mind that this is my priest. God can speak anything to him, to me through him. Understand and digest the mandate of the messenger. That is number three. This is how you can follow up his teaching and benefit from his call. Understand the message of the messenger. I'm going to be practical about this now. When I used to be in Salvation Ministries, I could tell when the Papa Ibiome announces topic, I can tell you detectively what he's going to teach. Ask my wife if you think I'm lying. Even till today, when they put on the flyers, I will tell my wife, this is what we say, this is what we will say, this will be the subheading. Have I not told you before? And after service, we will check church gist where they normally post this message. We will read to say exactly the things I've said. There will be a way you get into a man that you can easily predict. Do you know how to easily predict your priest? Let me tell you the truth now. Moses carries the message of the law. Who wrote all the laws in the Bible? This is how you understand your Bible, your pastor, and to understand any priest. These teachings are really taught. When somebody will teach you about the altar, altar this, altar, but the Holy Spirit detected this. I didn't read it from any book, but those are facts. Moses carries the message of the law, so those who followed him to obey law. Am I speaking to somebody? Abraham carried the message of obedience. So even Lot, everyone that followed Abraham, followed him for obedience. Say, if you obey me, your seed shall be greater than this stars you have seen. So everything about Abraham is obedience. Can you talk about obedience today without mentioning him? He's a father of obedience. Now, Catherine Coleman carries the message of the Holy Spirit. You want to learn about the Holy Spirit, who do you need to? Catherine Coleman, you enter Benny Hinn, you enter Pastor Chris. But all of them, Catherine Coleman, they know his message, so you know what you are going out for him. Kumuyi carries the message of what? Holiness. You see, before I say this, somebody has said it. He, when you understand your pastor, things that work in his hand, easily works in your hand. Now, another person again I'll talk about, Oyedepo carries the message of prosperity and faith. Everything, faith, prosperity. Ibiome carries the message of what? Prosperity. You understand this. When you have entered there from the 8 months you operated, you will know that I carry a message of courage and boldness. Every of my messages tied to courage and boldness to stir up something in you. So when you know the message your man of God carried, you know what to draw for him. The day God called me to ministry, he told me specifically, and I will write down the same way he told me. He said, you are called to preach the pure gospel with the mandate to dispense the tidings of peace. The message of the cross, that is why I can't preach without telling you about heaven and hell. And the reconciliation between man and God. No matter anything I teach you, I will tell you, reconcile with men. Whoever you offended, reconcile with them. These things can stop people from entering heaven. And they also give me to bring solution to the spiritual, physical, and relationship needs of men. So when we fix program, you know that this program is taken from this part of his teaching. This program, when we do relationship, say it's part of the call God gave him, relationship. So you make yourself available to be in a relationship program, because you can't submit to the college teaching and not be in the relationship preaching. That means there is something about that your priest, you have not accepted all. You accept the whole of his message. When we take life serious, life will give us serious results. We are not too young to have testimonies. We are not too small to have cats packed all over this place. Yes, we are not too small. We can take more by storm. If only you will take this message serious and tell yourself, enough of coming to church as a social club. It's time to see this place serious. Give me the business approach. Do you understand? I didn't come here to count, look at people's faces. I came here to change people, to transform people, to take over their generation. So if you think you are coming here every other Sunday morning, every other Wednesday evening and Friday evening, let's fulfill all righteousness, I go to church, I go back. No way! That is not the message and the calling God gave me. He gave me a drive to rekindle the passion of revival in the hearts of men, and to let you know that you can take over everything that belongs to you. So don't come here casual. Say, let me go to church again. No way. Give me the business approach. When they say go for evangelism, give me the business approach. Tell your yourself, this is my capital, this is my business, this is what I am born for, this is what I will do. And it will give you result. No man ever followed God casually and had blessings. Don't ever follow God casually. You must identify with what makes up the message of your priest so that you can connect to him. Benefit of connecting to his message. One, you become a reflection of his message. Somebody come to threaten you. Who be you? Do you know your pastor rowers in the realm of the spirit? You will row. As you see me like this, nobody can kill me. Spiritual or physical, you can't. I can't because I have seen 100 years how I want to live my life. So have that mentality. When you understand the man's message, you also carry that doggedness. You also carry that boldness. Say, oh, if my pastor acts like this, I will act like this too. You will see your pastor is never satisfied. I am not satisfied. When you come here today, one thing I've been added. When you come tomorrow, another thing I've been removed. Another one I've been added. I have never been satisfied. I have never been at one spot. Tomorrow you come. Maybe AC have entered. Another day you come. Another one I've entered. Before you come, one speaker. Before you come, we have big hall. Everywhere is bigger than it used to be. I have never been satisfied at this spot. So when you understand his message, you too will be as satisfied at this spot. When you want to give up, you just remember one of your messages of your pastor. I can't give up. Let me tell you something. The workload on the priest becomes lightened when you too carry his message. Like now, when I'm laboring in prayer for you, I'm praying. The prayers will not take me too much for God to answer. When you understand the message, when you understand his passion, not that pastor is crying out to God for evangelism and you don't even care about it. So even the prayers he's praying, it's becoming so difficult for God to answer. Understand his heart. Understand what drives his passion. And you will see yourself swim in glorious victory. Number four, connect to the flame of fire. I said connect to the altar, connect to the priest of the altar, connect to the message of the priest. And number four, connect to the flame of fire. Connect to the what? The flame of fire. There is no altar without fire. Both the church, both the pastor, both the message, three of them put together is the fire. Connect to the fire. If you check the book of Exodus chapter 3 from verse 1 to 7, Moses stepped into a bush and all of a sudden he saw the bush burning, but it was not consumed. He saw fire, but fire was not burning the bush. What did God do? He said, remove the shoes from your leg, for the place you are standing is an holy ground. In the Old Testament era, removing shoe is a sign of honor, is a sign of reverence, and is a sign of respect. Moses took off his shoes before he could connect to the holy fire. We are talking about how to connect to the fire now. Moses removed the shoe before he could go close to the fire to connect to the fire. He removed the shoe. There are things you must remove. Remove pride. Remove the disobedience. Remove, I hear it today, I won't do it tomorrow. No! Change! Live here with a passion of revival. Taking off your shoe means reverence. You reverence the fire, the message, the altar, the church. You reverence it. That is removing your shoe. It is humility, and the holy fire demands humility before you can connect to it. How to stay connected in the flame? And we pray. Number one, passion for prayer. Now I want to be connected to this fire. I want this fire to be burning continually in my spirit, somebody. Passion for what?
For prayer.
You know, we are in a generation now where people hardly pray. If I have my way to be calling everybody every night, say, pray, I will do it. Because you need prayers to stand up in life. Say, call to me and I will answer you and I will show you great and mighty things. Call unto me. How many times do we call on God? Passion for prayer. Don't stay like this and say, I can't pray. Step into your workplace, pray. Close your workplace, pray. Get home, pray. In the night, wake up, pray. When you stay, sleep cannot catch you. The Holy Spirit is telling you to pray, not to press for. When you do these things, nobody will cajole you, nobody will push you to love God. Prayers will rekindle your fire. Number two, passion for souls. After passion for prayer, passion for souls. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jews first and also to the Greek. You went for soul winning, they didn't come. Don't tell me you should give up. You invited them, you called them, and they didn't come. Didn't mean you should give up. You, we are we that are here now, is it one day that we accepted Jesus? They tried and tried and tried until one day we accepted Jesus. Keep on following them up. Have passion that, oh God, this message I heard today, I wish this person heard this message. I wish this person that is not in church today was here to hear this message. I wish this, my sister that is not here, my brother, have that passion. When you have that passion, God has a way of making it come to pass. It starts with passion. Passion for souls. Now, number three, passion for your own soul. After passion for another person's soul, have passion for your own soul. Matthew chapter 16, verse 26 says, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? After everything I teach you today, are we going to stand up again and leave the former lifestyles we are living? Not honoring the altar, not honoring the priest on the altar, not honoring the choir on the altar, and not wanting to connect to source. What shall it profit us when we run around in this whole world? Run around in business, run around in investment, run around in things, yet your money is not speaking in the house of God. Yet your resources is not felt on the altar. Yet your service, your prayer is not felt on the altar. What shall it profit us if we gain the whole world and lose our own soul? Somebody say, God forbid. Say, God forbid.
God forbid.
It will profit nothing. That after such a wonderful sermon like this, next Sunday I will need to preach it again. Upper Sunday I will need to preach it again. Upper Sunday I will need to preach it. No. This message took me grace for me to be able to say I will preach this. So it might take me a long time to preach it again. So you too can preach it for others who are not here. Sometimes when you pray, provoke the altar. When you pray, provoke the priest. When you pray, check the fire. Are you still connected to the fire? One way you can connect to the fire again is the prayer of tongues. Deep groanings. Not just fire, deep groan is that you are lost. Yeah, last night I prayed from 11:30 to 12, 6 minutes past 12 midnight in tongues. Consistently from 11:30 to 12 midnight. As I finished, I carried my pen and wrote down the things God told me. Pray and talk. There's not only pastor that need to be revived. When you are revived, it makes things easier. If you're not praying, you are praying at the same time. God will see, he is leading me signal. He will show you too. But then once he can show you quickly, I will beat it up. Let's connect and build this family. To a family where people will see and envy and say, wow, thank God. See, let me tell you something. Mark my words, between now and December, there will be a difference between people who will run with this message in this church. Between now and December, mark my words, write it at the end of your notes. That I say between now and December, there will be a difference between others and those who run with this message. Maybe you might be a visitor. Yes, the message is not a waste. Practice it where you are coming from. And if here is your house, practice it here. Between now and December, you practice to connect to the altar. You respect the altar and say, no matter anything, this altar must go to appear to service today. I must go to church today. I must do the things that the altar requires. Two, you connect to the priest on the altar. The same way you reverence the altar, you reverence the priest on the altar. Three, you connect to the message of the priest on the altar. When you see things from this church, you share them. When you receive flyers, you share them. You don't keep them. And you also connect to fire. I tell you the truth, between now and December, there will be a difference within us. Who wrong with it? And those who never run with it. And I see every one of us here testifying before December in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Is somebody blessed?
Yes.
Somebody blessed?
Yes.
Really blessed?
Yes.
Did I make somebody angry today?
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
You will run with what you have said.
Yes.
You will run with it.
Yes.
You run with it.
Yes.
Lift your hands to heaven like this. Say, oh God of heaven, give me the grace.
Give me the grace.
To run with what I have learned.
To run with what I have learned.
As you are seated now, raise thy hands high in heaven and begin to commit it to God. Now, Kashataya Bruno, Masikaya Bruno, lift your hands to heaven.
We believe you were blessed with today's episode of Pure Gospel Moment. For prayers, testimonies, or further inquiries, you can reach Mac Miracle on +234 812 328 8593. That is +234 812 328 8593. God bless you real good.